The excerpts from How to Rear a Child. Excerpt number 11 and 12. Excerpt 11. Child, the reservoir of unfathomable energy. Child, the reservoir of unfathomable energy. Before I begin with the excerpts, there are a few questions. I will read the question. Exactly at what moment does the soul enter within the womb? In today's session, that was the last session, the prenatal rearing, it was said that during this period something from the beyond enters the fetus. You may call this soul or life force. The fetus, which was breathing the life force through its connection with the mother via the umbilical cord up to now, starts breathing for the first time on its own. So, is it during this time soul enters the womb, or have the soul established any connection with the fetus even before that time? I have to take an analogy to explain. Suppose I am visiting your country, Sweden. The arrangements have to be made beforehand that on this particular day I will enter, because you have to make all the arrangements for me to stay. You have to see that all the facilities are available for this day, and because the purpose of my visit to your country and you is spiritual, you have to make arrangements so that my talks can take place. You have to explore your connections where you can have the talks of Tausha Buddha in your country, who you will invite, who you will like to be associated with Tausha Buddha. All these arrangements are made well in advance. Then on a particular time, precise time, through a particular flight, Tausha Buddha enters your country. In the same way, when arrangement is made, the parents have reached a certain level of energy field. Earlier on, maybe 5 years ago, your energy field was not strong enough to invite Tausha Buddha to your country or to your home. You have to have the inner preparation. What is he going to do when he comes to your country? Would he carry him for the sightseeing? He is not interested in sightseeing. Would you carry him to the clubs, social meetings? He is not interested in that. So it is that you have to do the preparation. When the preparation is done, if you have a political mind, you will invite the political persons to come to your place. If you are an outgoing social person, you will invite arrange those kind of functions, parties, and invite that kind of person to your house. But when you have to invite a spiritual person, you have to make the preparation in advance. If you have to invite your friends, what are you going to explain to the person? Who is this person, Tausha Buddha, and why is he dressed in this particular way? Why he has this ambience? When you are ready, you can invite the person. Because when I go to any country, my connections make the arrangements accordingly. According to the development of the person that is going to visit, his energy field, according to that, you make the arrangements. When I go to Boston, the arrangements are made for me to visit, because there the persons are of a different nature. They invite me to the functions that they are accustomed with. One of the person is a music teacher. Because of the Western influence. Whenever he teaches, he have the Indian music class. He speak a little bit of religious things. So he will carry me to those functions. He will have that audience. In the same way, when you have made the arrangements, means all the preparations are ready, then at a precise moment, the guest from the unknown and unknowable realm enters in the form of energy field, in the form of soul. So it is very difficult to predict at what time does the soul enter the room. It can happen anytime. So precisely the mystics have pointed out that enters in the last 3 months of the pregnancy. Or have the soul established the connection with the fetus even before that time? I just explained to you with the analogy. If you have to invite me, you have to invite, make the arrangements beforehand. Before I visit, all the arrangements of my different talks at different venues are ready. This is very natural and normal. When I visit Boston or Los Angeles or Florida, the people there, they are aware of my visit. They make the arrangements, inform the people, look, this person is coming, and the venues are reserved where the talks will be held. Some people may have a particular topic to be discussed. So all these things are pre-arranged. Now again, it is the host who has to decide what kind of people you will be inviting to that function when Tausha Buddha visits your country. Would you invite the politicians? Would you invite the party goers? You will invite those people who are spiritually inclined. It is the host who has to decide. In the same way, the host is the existence. And depending on your inner preparation, the preparation of the parents, the energy field of the parents, the existence decides. Because you remember, a very advanced soul cannot enter a womb unless it finds resonance with that energy field, unless that soul finds the opportunity to grow. So whenever I have to visit any country, any place, I have to decide who am I going to visit. What am I going to do there? Am I going just as a tourist? That is not the purpose. What am I going to do there? My work is a spiritual work, transformation of human consciousness. Amidst the crowd, there may be people who are at different level of consciousness. In some, the soil is to be prepared. In some, a fire is to be lit. And so on and so forth. It is the host, the death, the existence. When it finds, because there are souls that are ready to be born, but they are looking for a suitable womb. Will the soul of Buddha enter an ordinary womb? I have explained many times, basically there are 3 types of souls. The one is the ordinary soul that we see all around. Ordinary consciousness, eat, drink and be merry consciousness, who live their life according to the morality, according to their social norms, follow their, have a good understanding, parents, this and that. These are very common. The other type of soul is very advanced. The soul of Buddha, the soul of Mahavir, the soul of Jesus. All these are very advanced. They cannot be reborn through an ordinary womb, through an ordinary male-female relation. How many people enter every day in a country? There are some residents, there are some visitors, there are some dignitaries, and how many masters enter the country on a day-to-day basis? It is very rare. Master is a soul which is formless. Though he exists in the form, yet still he is formless. So it is the destiny. Destiny means a master is destiny. The moment master enters, leaves the so-called the formful life and enters into the formless realm through the door of death, he becomes existential. It is that soul has to decide whether this particular person is capable to host me or not. There are many people, when I visit, I look into what are the possibilities for me to carry my roof. All the people who are associated with me in each country, each city, they are spiritual according to varying degrees, but they are family people, they have the work to do. So sometimes they take a week off or days off, carry me around to different functions. Others cannot do that. Then there are people who go on making arrangements, or the arrangements are made prior to my visit. All these are preparations. It is I who has to decide where am I going to stay. So in the same way, the soul that has entered formless realm through the door of death is now existential. It has to decide, and decide at what precise moment, when all the arrangements are made, there is someone ready to receive you when you enter the new city, then it happens. And then the next question that asked, can you say about the background of the child or give some hints? Just remember, when you want to plant or grow flowers in your garden, when you want to grow a particular vegetable, you go and purposely, consciously buy that seed. If you have want to grow tomatoes, you buy tomato seed. You decide that I want to grow tomatoes in my backyard, or lettuce, or anything else. So when you buy the seeds from the garden shop or seedlings, you buy tomato seedlings. It may happen that there may be a glitch. This is the term that is used in computer technology. All of a sudden something bugs and then it is automatically corrected. In the same way, it may happen that the garden shop may have given you erroneously wrong seedlings. But that rarely happens because those people are experts. Then you have to wait. You have to provide first the correct environment for the seedling to grow. You know, you buy the seedlings of tomatoes. It requires a particular climate, particular type of soil as compared to rose plants. If you buy a white rose, the shopkeeper tells you this plant will bear white rose, or this orchid will be of this particular color. Then what you have to do? The moment you bring the plant, you prepare the soil according to the specifications for orchid or rose or tomato or lettuce plant, then you plant it and wait. That correct temperature, the soil, the environment that you have to provide for the tomato to grow into tomato rather than tomato growing as turnips, or the rose flower during the spring autumn season. During the spring season in cold countries, it requires a certain temperature. When the temperature is correct, the flower will grow to a particular size. Now there is chrysanthemum, there is dun, many other flowers. If you have too many flowers growing on one branch, the nourishment will be divided. The flower may not attain to its real potential. So when these plants are put, flower plants have to be prepared for the flower shows. When the person does continues to provide the nourishment, correct nourishment, and removes all the flower buds, so only one flower bud remains there, one or maybe two, and all the nourishment goes to that particular bud, and that grows into a phenomenal size here and that easy. You do not have to be impatient about it. Whether it will grow into a white rose or pink rose, you had requested the garden shop for a white rose. They are experienced, expert in providing you the correct plant. The possibility of glitch exists, but when you bring the plant, you mention it to your wife and children that I have bought a white rose plant. Out of anxiety, they may want to see the white rose, but where is the white rose? You have to tell them that you have to wait. The plant has to be planted on the flower bed. Then you have to wait for a certain time for it to catch the roots and then begin to grow. Then one day it will attain to fruition, the true colors. Doesn't it happen that way? What instructions and hint do you need about the plant? You have requested a white rose. When the plant is properly nourished and taken care of, it will bring the white rose. In the same way, you have requested a master to have been blessed with a child. What the master will do? He will not give you a politician consciousness. You have requested a master of the stature of Jalaluddin Rumi. What would he bless? He will bless a child that comes out of his consciousness. Again, it depends upon the environment that you provide to the child, the kind of nourishment you provide to the child. That's why I mentioned that share your love with the child. Share your life stories, the stories of the great men of that, not the politicians, not the life history of Hitler. There may be certain points of him, his life, that may be very relevant. But you speak about the life of those masters, those men of substance. You are providing the environment. You are providing the nourishment to the child. When the child is lying in the crib and you want to create the colors, it is said, and even when we have the musical, the things that are hung on in the crib, it has big pictures and bright colors. The same way, you can make your own arrangement to hang the pictures of those places, the masters, colorful images. So the child grows in that environment, the environment of lovingness, not quarreling among the husband and wife over petty and the trivial matters, providing the environment. Then the plant that you have requested from the shopkeeper will bear its true potentials. There is no need to ask for the hints. The time and your upbringing, your love will reveal that automatically. So this much is on the questions that you had asked. Child, the reservoir of unfathomable energy, the excerpt 11. When the first child is born, the existential bioenergy of the parent is on the rise. This can be seen in the energy field of the child. However, thereafter, the descent of this existential bioenergy begins. And by the time the last child is born, the downward trends of marriage has begun. The child brings an unknown potential and there is no way to figure out what he is going to be. So no procedure can be suggested. Certainly, this is the way you should help the child. And each child is unique. So there cannot be a general discipline for every child. The lovingness, harmony and oneness between the parents are replaced with rancor, hatred, animosity, disharmony, bitterness, resentment, disagreement and quarrel for everything. Marriage has failed to attain its purpose. The energy begins to wane and downward trend has begun. Woman leans towards the youngest son. In that she looks her husband and the son as well. The child grows in the shadow of the mother. In the process of constant acrimony with the husband, she uses the child as a tool against the husband. This creates problems for the child later in his life. However, this is how life goes on and your legacy as well. Certainly there are people like Judith Martin and others who are suggesting measures for every child as if children are produced on an assembly line in a factory. No two children are the same. No generalized program can be suggested for the growth of the children. Each child is unique and has to be managed that way alone. Perhaps finally, when she became famous and the well-known authority on child rearing, nobody dares to marry her again, because such a woman who has no compassion on children, do you think she will have compassion on husbands? She will train them exactly the way animals are trained in a circus. She will make them dance to her tune, and her being a famous, world-famous authority, what can the poor husband do except to dance to her tune? This kind of person has existed down the ages around the world everywhere. They have prescriptions, recipes and disciplines for everybody. Not only for their contemporaries, but for all future generations too, as to what is right. They are so idiotic, although they are known as great sages, who have given you religions, disciplines, moralities, ethics, and codes of conduct. Such people are considered great lawgiver. Certainly these people are idiots. Only an idiot can think in a generalized way as far as human beings and children are concerned. For generalization, always an average human being will be needed. But you will never come across the average man or an average child. And all these authorities are concerned with the average man who does not exist. The average man is just like God, omnipresent, yet you cannot find him anywhere. God is so omnipresent that he has become invisible and very average. Each child, each person is unique because there is no parallel. He is not omnipresent like your God, who is supposed to be very average being. The uniqueness of the person is that there is no parallel to him in any way, physical, intellectual, mental, or otherwise. I have heard about a nun who lived in a monastery. The whole monastery became concerned about her. Everyone wondered if she was sick or something because she was taking her bath with her clothes on and the doors were closed in the bathroom. And when they inquired her, "What is the matter and why don't you undress when the doors are closed and nobody is there?" her reply was really significant. "Nobody? What do you mean? What do you all mean by this? God is omnipresent. Yes, there is none of you, but God is there, and to undress before God does not look right, does it?" They all must have thought her crazy, because she has accepted the idea of omnipresence of God, exactly like omnipresent God is the average man considered to be present, exactly like omnipresent God is the average man expected to be present everywhere. But you do not generalize a person, because each person is unique. It is not mathematical that, or the price of a commodity. If you want to know the something about the price structure, you take the average price of a particular commodity. But that is a different matter altogether. Average man exists nowhere and is supposed to exist everywhere, but only hypothetically. And all the principles are addressed to the average man. All theories of economics or anything else are based on the average. You ask me how to help the child in the right way? No, it cannot happen, because each child is unique. When you prepare the flower bed, you prepare a flower bed for rose, a flower bed for chrysanthemum, a flower bed for dahlia, a flower bed for dianthus and many other flowers. It is a unique, personalized, individualized way. Excerpt 12. The right way of child rearing. If you really have courage, then please do not help the child. Love him and nourish him. What you do when you plant a rose plant? You prepare the soil, you nourish him by fertilizers, by providing the right amount of temperature and the moisture. You provide, make sure that the leaves are growing properly. If there is any bulb or anything, you remove it immediately. But the plant grows on its own. This much we understand. So to love the child, nourish him, let him do what he wants to do, let him grow on his own, let him go where he wants to go. Your mind will be tempted again and again to input, and with good excuses in the name of game. The mind is very clever in rationalizing. You may be thinking that after all I am going to tell the right way of child rearing. It means you are still caught in your mind training the way. Certainly the right way to child rearing is not to help the child at all. This way he will attain to the peak of his consciousness or the crescendo of understanding. Remember, the peak of consciousness is Buddhahood or Christhood or enlightenment. If you have a real courage, then please do not help the child. Love him and nourish him. Let him do what he wants to do. Let him go where he wants to go. Your mind will be tempted again and again to interfere, and with good excuses in the name of caring. The mind is very clever in rationalizing. If you do not interfere, there may be many dangers. The child may fall into the well if you do not stop him, or he may get sick if he goes out in the rain, or he may fall in trying to climb the tree. All kinds of fear are there in her and the mind rationalizes everything. However my words may appear harsh to you, still I say to you, it is better to let him fall into the well than to help him and destroy him. It is a rare possibility the child falls from the tree, and then too, it does not mean death in any way. He can be taken care of. If you are really so concerned, the well can be covered, but do not help the child, and also do not interfere with the child. The well can be removed, so too the tree can be pruned or cut completely, but do not interfere with the child. The real concern should be to remove all dangers, but not to interfere with the child. Allow him to go on his way. You will have to understand some significant growth patterns. This is the way you can help the child to grow. This is the way you can rear a child to blossom into a flower, the potentiality of which he carries in his youth. If the rose plant that you bought from the garden shop is not properly nourished, the process or the soil is not well prepared according to the specifications, then plant may grow crooked, the flower will not attain to its full potential, it may grow as dwarf, or maybe in the absence of nourishment, very tiny flowers may grow. But you remember you had bought a rose plant that will bear the flowers to a particular size, particular color, particular ambience. For this you have to provide the correct nourishment, correct care according to the growth of the plant. And for the growth of the child, the lovingness and freedom is very essential. If a child does not do mischief, who else will do? If you start child from being innovative in what he does, where will he learn the innovations to be innovative? And when you look around the people, they have lost the sense of innovations. Whether it is cooking, whether it is anything, the innovative trends are lost. We have become a stereotype. This is not the way to rear the child. Only this much on these two excerpts, 11 and 12, along with response to your question. Take care until tomorrow.